शृणुयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्ये माक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टुवागोऽसस्तनूभिः व्यशेम देवहितं यदायुः स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। आत्मानमरणिम् कृत्वा प्रणवम् चोत्तरारणिम् ज्ञाननिर्मथनाभ्यासात् पाशम् दहति पण्डितः स एव माया परिमोहितात्मा शरीरमास्थाय करोति सर्वम् स्त्रियन्नपानादिविचित्रभोगैः स एव जाग्रत्परितृप्तिमेति स्वप्ने स जीवः सुखदुःखभोक्ता स्वमायया कल्पितविश्वलोके सुषुप्तिकाले सकले विलीने तमोऽभिभूतः सुखरूपमेति पुनश्च जन्मान्तरकर्मयोगात् स एव जीवः स्वपिति प्रबुद्धः पुरत्र ये क्रीडति यश्च जीवस्ततस्तु जातम् सकलम् विचित्रम् आधारमानन्दमखण्डबोधम् यस्मिल्लयम् याति पुरत्रयम् च एतस्माज्जायते प्राणो मनः सर्वेन्द्रियाणि च खम् वायुर्ज्योतिरापः पृथिवी विश्वस्य धारिणि यत्परम् ब्रह्म सर्वात्मा विश्वस्यायतनम् महत् सूक्ष्मात् सूक्ष्मतरम् नित्यम् तत्त्वमेव त्वमेव तत् जाग्रत्स्वप्नसुषुप्त्यादिप्रपञ्चम् यत्प्रकाशते तद्ब्रह्माहमिति ज्ञात्वा सर्वबन्धैः प्रमुच्यते त्रिषु धामसु यद्भोग्यम् भोक्ता भोगश्च यद्भवेत् तेभ्यो विलक्षणः साक्षी चिन्मात्रोऽहम् सदाशिवः मय्येव सकलम् जातम् मयि सर्वम् प्रतिष्ठितम् मयि सर्वम् लयम् याति तद्ब्रह्माद्वयमस्म्यहम् अणोरणीयानहमेव तद्वन्महानहम् विश्वमहम् विचित्रम् पुरातनोऽहम् पुरुषोऽहमीशो हिरण्मयोऽहम् शिवरूपमस्मि।
The individual goes through the three states of consciousness, which is the waking, dream and deep sleep. The continuity is there because of the karma that a person has undergone. For example, whatever karma is unfinished in the previous day, after sleep, you continue from the same place where you left the next day. This cycle continues within our lifetime. It is easily understandable. Now all that we need to do is to project and understand this from a bigger picture. If you are able to conceive one lifetime as one waking state, and then just as the waking state goes into unmanifestation during sleep, this lifetime goes into unmanifestation as far as that individual is concerned into the state of death. And then what happens? Death is not the finality. Just as manifestation and unmanifestation are a continuous cycle, exactly in a bigger sense, the unmanifestation and manifestation at the level of birth and death is also a continuous cycle. Exactly like here, how you continue from where you left the previous day, it is also said that in the next Janma, we continue from exactly where we left in the previous Janma and we continue from there. What is exactly continuing us? We may not be able to carry whatever we are possessing here at this point of time in this Janma here. None of this body or its associated things that we have, wealth, etc., is going to come. Whatever is the proportion of the knowledge and ignorance, if you want to put it that way. In other words, ignorance is the other side of the knowledge. From where you live in this Janma, exactly from that point you continue in the next Janma. What is the connection? It is your karma that is the connection. So he says, Punascha Janmantara Karma Yogat. See, this reincarnation is very much a living faith as it is. When I say living faith, not in the sense of a practice, it cannot be understood or it cannot be empirically proven, but it is in the faith of people who follow this Sanatana Dharma or Hinduism and also the cousin religions or the associated religions like Buddhism, Jainism, etc., which are Indic religions. And everybody accepts it is because of the karma. But since this cannot be empirically proved that there is a birth after death, it is formulated as a theory. Theory is also a science, scientific based, but it just cannot be proven to a person's satisfaction. It is not possible. On the other hand, law also follows the same criteria, but it is proven. That is why we say it is law of karma. Law of karma, or like in physics or even in normal science, we talk about law of gravitation. Law of gravitation is that with reference to the earth, every object is attracted at a particular force, particular acceleration. In case of earth, it is 9.8 meter per second square. Otherwise, every object attracts every other object in the proportion of the mass of the object and inversely proportional to the distance between them. This is a law. This law can be proved. This law can be understood. If a person is not able to understand at a lower level, with education of science, which understanding, with development of intellect, he can understand it. It can be empirically proven to him. So therefore, it is called as law. Now, the mother of all laws is the law of karma, which is the law of causation. Law of causation is that every cause has an effect and every effect has a cause. In fact, all other scientific laws are based on this law only, which is based on the law of cause and effect. Whether it is laws in economics or science or maths or any law, it is this. If the world is not functioning according to certain laws, to formulate all other laws is not possible at all. Therefore, we say it is a cosmos. There is a perfect order here. Now, science talks about conservation of energy. Energy is neither created nor destroyed as far as what we know in the manifest universe. It only changes form. And energy and matter are interconvertible. These are all the established laws of science. Now, Vedanta says, you look at your own thoughts and desires from this angle, that they are also energies. So, when a person is moving from place to place, going from experience to experience, there is an energy that pushes him to do this. That energy is in the form of your aims, your ambitions, your desires, your thoughts, your emotions. All this is the bundle that is operating within you. That is your subtle body. That is your mind and intellect. That is what is pushing you from experience to experience. And all our actions are dependent on the direction of the desires, intensity of the desires, amalgamation of various desires operating at a particular point of time. All these things comes together to determine which direction we are going, what we are doing, etc. Now, at the end of one's life in this body, which we did denote as death, what happens to all the energies that are still there waiting to express itself. We see that even as an old person, he has a lot of desires left. There is a lot of things that he wants to achieve or wishes. It is not that he is in an absolute paripurna state where there is no vritti or there is no agitation of desires. It is not that case. So there is, we see that in Bhajagovindam Adishankaracharya says, Vriddho yati grihitva dandam tatapinam munchati ashapindam. The man has become old, the body has become old, but his desires are still fresh. So there is a lot of desires that is left. So what happens to such desires? To say that they go into a vacuum is not appealing scientifically. It is not possible. But we do not know what happens. But we do know that there are unfinished agenda. There are energies which still have propensities, which have chance to further manifest and satisfy themselves. It is still there. Just as in this lifetime we saw our own desires coming up from our vasana, it is said that also we don't know, but thoughts we can understand, then it comes as desires, then it comes as action, and there is a fulfillment of desire. Like this, if it is was this cycle that was going on in this lifetime of ours, the propensity or the potential for the unfinished desires also remains at the end of this lifetime. But it is very clear that this body is no more the vehicle with which those desires are going to be fulfilled, because this body is no more useful for that. The jiva inside, the subtle body inside, decides that I am not going to use this body anymore. So this, what happens to this body, that is very clear. All the five elements of this body mix with the five elements. Either it is burnt and later buried, whatever it is. This body becomes like a dead matter, like any other matter in this world. But what is not understood or what cannot be seen is what happens to those thoughts and desires inside. So one end we see that there are unfinished desires which seemingly go somewhere, but we do not know where. This is one side of the equation. On the other side of the equation is the examination of newborn babies. The newborn babies have distinct tendencies, distinct propensities, they show distinct character. Even twins born to the same parents show different character. Sometimes it may coincide with the characteristics of parents, but sometimes it is totally different also. Because as far as science can go, it goes into the law of heredity and proposes that all the propensities and everything comes from your genes, which is from your parents, etc. It is telling us. No, but certain distinct tendencies seem to show at a very young age, which probably you cannot account for it in this lifetime. A child picks up a bat and plays cricket at a very young age. Some child gets into music and singing at a very young age. It is not possible that it has learnt the art which needs probably lot of practice in this janma only. Similarly, various other tendencies are being seen in the newborn child. Now, where could this have come from? This should have come from somewhere, we do not know where. This is what they examined. So when they examined that, on the one side where during death all the desires, all the thoughts, all the energies vanish into as it were nothingness. It's not nothingness, it goes somewhere. Similarly, during birth all these desires, all these tendencies, vasanas come as it were from nothingness, which is from somewhere. So when they audited the account of life like this, they come to a very logical conclusion that A person who goes this side must reappear from this side. This is called as a theory. Shakespeare says in, I think, As You Like It, all the world is a stage, all men and women mere players, they have their exits and entrances. He uses the term exits and entrances, not entrances and exits. So it's very clear. I mean, he is sort of referring to this only. You have your exit, you have your entrance. But behind the screen, what is happening? Nobody knows. But there is an exit and there is an entrance that is coming. This is called as a theory of reincarnation. This is very scientific. Now, then we go to the scriptures like Gita and Upanishad like this. We see this corroborated by various statements which are taken as authoritative statements. So, it is giving a further boost when Krishna says in 6th chapter of Gita that a person who has undergone spiritual sadhana, but he has not achieved the ultimate, he is going to be born in a house of pure and wealthy people. So that is a very clear indication that your effort doesn't go waste. You will continue there. Athava yoginam eva kule bhavati dhimatam. Otherwise, he is born in the house of yogis, but that type of a birth is very rare, he says. Because how, what is the effort that you have put in and how much you have fallen determines these births. And then he says, there in conjoint to the efforts of the previous janma, he puts in more effort from there and continues. So, he very clearly talks about the continuity also. So, all this is covered in just one word here, punascha janmantara karma yogat. Again, by connection with the actions of the previous janma, the same jiva, the same individual, plays about in the three cities, which is the waking dream and deep sleep. Again, it wakes up and again it sleeps, and it plays about here. Yaha puratraye kridati sa eva jivaha swapiti prabuddhaha. The same individual is born again and again. It is talking about, as I said, the theory of reincarnation. Now, as I said, you can examine your life in this janma itself. It is going through a series of births and deaths if you understand the stages of your life. A child may be dead here and born in a boarding school somewhere else. It is like that. So, how you go from experience to experience here, that is how you go from one experience to another experience at the end of this life. So, therefore, death is also taken as one more experience here. Then he says, Yasmin layam yati puratrayam cha. In whom all these three cities, puratrayam, layam yati. Yeah, layam means a sort of a merger, a dissolution. Tataha tu jatam sakalam vichitram. Where it goes at the end of all unmanifestation somewhere, from there only arises all this vichitram, he says. Vichitram means wonderful, wonderment. This plurality, this is called as vichitram. These varied things, varied, wonderful, it is translated here. See, this word is always used with reference to this universe. It is wonderful, it is vichitram. In other places, it is talked about as ascharya. What is wonderful about this pluralistic phenomenon is, however much we try to fathom it with our intellect, we cannot understand how and why this design is created like this. But it seems to work in a perfect order. That is why it is wonderful. When do we say something is a wonder? When it is beyond our intellect. See, for a person who does not know any basics of science, when a rocket goes upwards, it is something wonderful. Because he has seen everything only come down, but this is defying the gravity and goes up. For a rocket scientist who probably has designed it or who is part of the team who is launching the rocket, it is not a big deal. It's not a big deal in the sense he understands the science behind it. He won't say it is wonderful. But for a person who has not understood it, who cannot understand it with its limited intellect, or how a puppet show is being seen as a wonder by a child. For the child, the puppet, the two dolls or few dolls there are dancing by themselves, it is wonderful. But as grown-ups, we can understand that there is one hand which is operating these dolls. So it is not a wonder, yet you enjoy it. Exactly like that, we are able to, as the individual, able to enjoy this great universe. But it is this plurality which is Vichitram. This Vichitram is wonderful because of a perfect unison with which the forces are working here. From where this has come, that source, it is that same source into which all the three cities go into at the point of dissolution. Now, this can be further understood. In other words, first he talked about the cycle of manifestation and unmanifestation with reference to an individual, which is on a daily basis. Daily we go through these three states of consciousness called waking, dream and deep sleep. That is what he explained in the 12th and 13th mantra, and he elaborated it as to what and how it does. In the 14th mantra, he talks about that and he says, exactly the same way, the individual at the end of the life goes through the manifestation and unmanifestation. Now you further project it and understand, it is in the same way that the manifestation and unmanifestation of the total universe also happens. So, in other words, whatever has to be understood at the universe level, if you are able to understand it at the individual level, you will be able to project it and understand that it is in the same formula, same mechanism that it is functioning. Yat pinde tad brahmande. Whatever is the formula for the microcosm is the same formula for the macrocosm also. If you are able to understand one drop of water and examine what is its composition, it is a whole ocean also. If you are able to see the sun getting reflected in one drop of water, the whole ocean also reflects the same sun only. So the properties which are there in the essence, which is in microcosm, it is there in the macrocosm also. So we really do not know or can't understand when the world is created, how it is created, what cycle it has come from, etc., which is right. But if you are able to understand with reference to what is happening with reference to the individual microcosm, you can project it and understand what will happen or what should happen with reference to macrocosm also. Then we will be able to understand these statements. These statements are given from that standpoint in the Upanishad. The same three cities which are going into unmanifestation and manifestation, somewhere it goes, that source is where, from which the entire universe has become manifest and into which everything will finally dissolve. So that is another bigger cycle that is parallelly going on. That's all it is. So you see a small cycle within one day, you see a slightly bigger cycle within one lifetime, then you see a bigger cycle where individual goes through various life cycles across janmas, then you are able to see the same with reference to the totality of the universe. That also goes through manifestation and unmanifestation. Now, what is that source? That source, he says in three words here, Aadharam, Anandam, Akhandabodham. That which, where it everything goes into that laya, into that merger, into that dissolution, it is called as Aadharam. Aadharam means substratum. Substratum means that which is the base material, that into which everything is absorbed. See, for example, again, we can only imagine with the example of ocean. Ocean is the vast substratum into which all the waves and all other disturbances in the top of the ocean get absolutely dissolved. You imagine, after a while, everything comes into a standstill and the ocean is there remaining as it is. That ocean remains as the Aadharam. So therefore, even when the wave arises from the ocean and assumes a separate existence by itself, the wave out of delusion, if it is assuming that type of a thing, even then it is not different or separate from the substratum. So the substratum of ocean remains as it is. So likewise, even as you play through these three cities of waking, dream and deep sleep, you are still remaining as the same unbroken consciousness. That is what is the substratum here. The basic material which is going through all these things is nothing but that. So that basic material is referred to here as ஆதாரம். தென் ஆனந்தம். ஆனந்தம் இஸ் cannot be translated again. It's, you can say it's bliss. It's unbroken bliss. Very interesting word that he used in the 13th mantra. Again, each and everything you have to sometimes understand in the context in which the words are also used. But here it is very clear that in 13th mantra he used the word sukharupameti. Sukharupameti. In deep sleep, the individual gets into the sukharupam. There he uses sukham. And here he says, whatever that substratum is, it is anandam. What is the difference between sukham and anandam? Sukham is limited. Sukham has end, which is the starting point of dukkham. Dukkham has an end, which is the starting point of dukkham, sukham. So, dukkham and sukham are pairs of opposites which we experience in the world. In common parlance, sukham is something that we get from a sense contact, a satisfaction that you derive where your mind's agitation ceases with reference to any contact born pleasure, that is called as sukham. But here obviously he uses the word sukharupameti with reference to deep sleep. It is not applicable there, but still it is a limited joy in the sense there is a period where which this deep sleep goes into either dream or waking. You wake up after that. Then that sukham is not anymore there. You are going through your normal worldly things. That sukham which is devoid of any desires, which is devoid of any thoughts, which probably you became in the deep sleep, that state of nothingness is also limited. So a person goes through this in a cycle. But this anandam, unlike sukham, has no opposite term. It cannot be understood, it cannot be explained, it cannot be parallelly given as any other joy or anything that we experience in this world. It is of a different kind altogether. It is your swarupa, or what is your original nature itself. So this the other Upanishad like Taittiriya Upanishad, it tries to bring out the quantification of ananda by certain formula. It is also again a magnificent effort of the Upanishad to do that. But then finally it goes into a projection and it leaves it to you for there to imagine that ananda. So it talks about a pleasure that a person derives in this world when he is perfect at all levels. He is talking about a person who is having the best of the things in the world, whatever you can aspire for or think of. He is number one in health, he is number one in wealth, he is number one in beauty, strength, character, education, everything in this world, whatever a person aspires, family, each and everything is provided to him and he is, let us say, satisfied by everything which is outstanding in every aspect. He says that satisfaction is one unit of happiness. If you assume, if that happiness is one unit, then he says what a person normally would have as a normal person in the heaven will have 100 times that happiness. 100 times that. It is unimaginable. See, when I say this terrestrial joy itself is unimaginable. How can a person can be perfect in everything? That itself is a great imagination. So from there, beautifully our imagination is perched higher and higher. So he talks about 100 times that person in the heaven. That is, let's say a manager in the heaven, his happiness. 100 times that person's happiness is Indra's happiness. 100 times that Indra's happiness is Brihaspati's happiness. 100 times Brihaspati's happiness is Brahma's happiness. Like that, it goes on exponentially increasing. So beyond a point, it becomes blurred for us. Even when you talk about scams, 1,76,000 crore was the figure given. Beyond a point, how many zeros you add, it doesn't make any difference because it becomes blurred after a point. So like that, but beautifully it quantifies. And then he says, Brahma's pleasure is also not even a lava. Lava means a fractional pleasure of a person who has realized the self. realizing the self is going to the original nature where your swarupa of Satchitananda is realized, nothing else. So that ananda is equated to that sort of a pleasure, which is an unbroken bliss, where you are in that continuous existence of pleasure. That is called as anandam. Adharam, anandam, akhanda bodham, again consciousness. Akhanda bodham means unbroken consciousness. All our consciousness, which are conditioned consciousness, are limited. They are broken from time to time. Broken means we are conscious of the waking state now. When we are dreaming, we are conscious of the dream at that point of time. When we are at deep sleep, we are conscious of nothing at that point of time. Again, waking state is another conditioned consciousness. Dream state is another conditioned consciousness. Deep sleep is like that. So, all these states are called as conditioned consciousness. Conditioning means the pure consciousness is, as it were, reflected through an external medium which does not appear to be what it is originally. So, a pure water, when it is passing through a tube which is, let us say, a transparent glass, but it is colored then red and blue, then the water appears blue, the water appears yellow. So that yellow water is said to be conditioned, but in essence, in actual, that water is not conditioned, but we go through that as a conditioned consciousness only. So we cannot understand what that pure consciousness is. That is what he says is the adharam, anandam, akhanda bodham. So that is that pure state into which everything dissolves and from where everything evolves further. Again, through the connection with the actions of previous birth, that individual self alone dreams, awakes and plays in the three cities. From him indeed arises the pluralistic phenomena, and into whom the substratum, bliss, unbroken consciousness, the three cities dissolve. We'll chant mantra 15. Yes, sir.
Yeah. You talked about macrocosm and microcosm. In macrocosm, we have what you call dream world. In macrocosm, what is the dream world?
See, in the microcosm, we have the dream world, which is within the individual as it is. So, when we talk about this dream world, it is the undigested thought flow of the waking state that we spin and go through, which is what an individual goes through. Exactly like that, if you are able to project probably, the equivalent of that is the other lokas probably that we go through after death. So in other words, dream occurs within the sleep. One aspect of the sleep where you go through something is called as the dream. If we equate death to sleep, so in the time of death, in that period of death, whatever be that period, we do not know. Something that you go through. Now this dream which we go through, which is based on the experiences of the waking state, there is a connection. Exactly like that, there is a connection with reference to what all karma that we have done in this lifetime, we will go through something. So if we have led a probably a pure life, we will go through heaven. If we lived a selfish life, we go through hell. Heaven, hell and various other intermediary stages, whatever we go through, can be equated to that. Yes, sir.
We talk about happiness increasing exponentially.
Right.
But to get this ultimate anandam, it can only come through a stage where we are now, because we are the karma unit.
Right.
For a person, normally we think of that infinite happiness, but when we talk about the intermediate happiness of Indra or Brahma, they have to come again to our level before they reach that ultimate, isn't it?
That's right. In the sense, from the point of view of qualitative happiness, what we go through. See, suppose it is said that from the human birth here, we can gain the knowledge of the self and reach that state. But statistically speaking, one in a million or one in a generation may do it. Okay. Now, all other beings, what we go through is a bouts of joy and sorrow that we go through like that. Whatever we go through at this point of time, if you compare this with reference to those higher beings which are at higher lokas, their joys are higher and higher. So this is to understand that whatever experience that you go through here, there can be superior or inferior experience also. A person who is in Naraka might go through an inferior experience in terms of agitation than this. But finally, when it comes to self-realization, it is said that it is possible that you attain that state of liberation from this Janma only here, like that it is said. Yes, sir.
Again, micro and macrocosm. Individuals, as you said, to understand this, they are operating at micro level and the entire universe at macro level. So, an individual once becomes self-realized, he merges into God, and then it loses its entity as such. But the universe has no beginning and the end. So, how will it lose its entity at all?
That's what it is. As far as you are concerned, the individual is concerned, he has merged his personality with Brahman. So, he has become Brahman as it were. He has become that substratum. Now, universe, whether it is, as far as that individual is concerned, the universe as you experience now doesn't exist. What exists is only Brahman and Brahman everywhere. In fact, what he perceives, what he experiences is only Brahman. So, from the individual's point of view, the enlightenment is a stage where what Ishavasya Upanishad talks about as Ekatvam Anupashyata. He becomes the perceiver of oneness. So, that when that oneness only is there, from that we derive what we are understanding or seeing as a pluralistic phenomena as a universe is nothing but that same consciousness only. So, therefore, the question doesn't arise from his standpoint at all.
Even the universe itself, you see it as Brahman.
So that's all it is. What you see as universe is actually Brahman only. That is the enlightenment that he gets into.
Sir, can I interrupt? Sorry, I'm just getting a little. When we are talking about Brahman in this context, we are talking at the physical aspect of the Brahman, right? See, when we are comparing the waking state, dream state, and the deep sleep state. The awake state, we sort of associate it more, with the physical awareness. And when we are talking about the universe also, in the awaking state, what he was talking about, you know, what will be the dream state of the Brahman?
You don't confuse. Brahman doesn't have a waking dream and deep sleep. First of all, remove that idea out of your mind. Okay, Brahman remains as Brahman. Whoever goes through these three states, he is only an individual. This individual, I am saying, goes through these three states while awake within this lifetime into what we know. What we do not know is beyond death. So, what you go through in the heaven or hell can be equated to dream. That's all I said. Don't bring in Brahman here.
I was talking about the macrocosm, at the macrocosm level. How does the three states function?
That's what I'm saying. The three states belongs to the individual. With reference to universe, you only understand that it will go into the manifest and unmanifest. That's about all. Okay. It goes into the manifest and unmanifest form. That's all. So, in totality, in microcosm, just as we are referring to these three names as Vishwa, Tejasa and Prajna, there are three names that are given with reference to macrocosm also as Virat. Virat is the manifest universe in this form. Hiranyagarbha and Ishvara. Ishvara is the state where it is in a state of cosmic deep sleep. Okay. So, all these names are also, I'll leave it for you to think about as to why it is. Hiranyagarbha means it's a golden egg, golden womb. So, therefore, the cosmic subtle body is called as Hiranyagarbha. And this total gross body is called as Virat. Virat means the universe. So, exactly if you are able to visualize it with reference to individual, the same visualization is there with reference to universe. Mantra 15 we'll chant twice.
Etasma jayate prano manas sarvendriyani cha kham vayur jyotirapah prithivi vishvasya dharini. Etasma jayate prano manas sarvendriyani cha खं वायुर्ज्योतिरापः पृथिवी विश्वस्य धारिणी.
From this, the support of the universe, arise prana, vital air, mind, all sense organs, space, air, fire, water and earth. A very famous mantra again. The same mantra appears, exactly the same mantra appears in Mundaka Upanishad. Second Mundaka, second part, first section, mantra 3. Verbatim the same mantra comes. This is talking about like a theory of creation. A similar idea again comes in what we see in Mundaka Upanishad again, first part, first section, mantra 8. There it talks about tapasa chiyate brahma tatonnam abhijayate annat prano manasatyam loka karmasu chamritam. The same type of order is given there also. But verbatim same mantra comes later in Mundaka also, and it comes here. There are various theories of creation that are given as to how this universe has come about. We have to always remember when we go through these theories of creation, what he said in the beginning of mantra 13, sa eva maya parimohitatma. It is all the play of maya finally, which really, really cannot be understood as a pinpointed creation. Because if a pinpointed creation like that exists, only then that can be explained. So therefore, these are all scientific theories, and you will see the science behind it. In this small mantra, so much of science is packed. But the law of causation, the science works from 0.01% to 99.9% in this universe. Beyond that, what it is really, we do not know. So there also the law of, that is why we say, with reference to your evolution also, perfect law of cause and effect functions. You do karma yoga, bhakti yoga, jnana yoga, how your thoughts get knocked off, everything is on a basis of cause and effect. Finally, you reach up to that point and you be there in the deep state of meditation. You bring it to that single point. That's all we can do. How that goes into self-realization, no cause and effect can explain, because it is a transformation from finite to infinite. So after 99.9%, okay, extend to 99.999 or 9999. Like that we can see, but all that is again finite. After that it is not 100%, it is infinite. So that transition we do not know. If we are able to understand this on this side, exactly you can understand in the left side, that similarly how it came from infinite into finite. So 0.001% when it is there, then from that onwards you can explain everything. See this, we have to learn this from science. In the 80s or early 80s, when I think the Big Bang theory was proposed, I think the first person who proposed this was a religious person, right? If I am not mistaken. He was ridiculed about Big Bang theory. Then it gained much more weightage and popularity, and then they were talking about certain thing exploding as it is, from where even the time-space causation itself was created. In other words, that expansion that they are talking about is not the expansion in space as we see here. So, that is still a mystery that is they are trying to unravel. And there were further researchers into that theory, and then each and every time they came up with more conclusions, the age of the universe went backwards, you know, still they are working on it. But what is it that actually it exploded? Nobody can say, and still they have not found out, it cannot be found out. So, in fact, when we study Mundaka, that Big Bang will very beautifully fit into that theory of creation, what mantra I just mentioned, you can go and refer to that. It says that only tapasa chiyate brahma. Tapasa chiyate brahma means by tapas, Brahman expands. That expand, the word itself is given there. It is expanding from the self. So from that expansion, plop, it pop out, and then the first thing came. Once the first thing is explained, whether you call it the first vasana or it's the first atom or first whatever it is thought, once the first thing is explained, first genes or first cell or whatever is the first, from that first how it multiplies or divides and makes it into a plurality is very obvious and understandable. And then finally, this evolution, when it goes into involution, finally when it goes into it dissolves and dissolves and eats further and eats further and becomes one finally, up to that point also it can be expanded. So whenever there is expansion, there will be a contraction also, that is all understood. But who and what expanded first? If something expanded first, then there must be some place where it is not there, it has to expand. All this will not exactly fit into 100% of our understanding, our known logic that is given here, where you say it is all pervading, etc. But these are very, very scientific theories still. So we have to understand these theories within this limit. It is no great intelligence trying to question, you only said Brahman is all pervading, how can it expand further? It is not a very big deal to ask that question. You have to understand the theory given that, because you are asking for the theory. When he says there is no creation, accept that and just see the Brahman. You are not able to see it. You are seeing universe, you are seeing the world, you are seeing yourself only as individuality. You go through a lot of sukha and dukkha based on it. So what we need is some remedy at the relative level. And therefore, when a curious question is asked as to how this universe is created, etc., to appease the mind of the person who is asking the question, various theories are given. And various theories are given for seekers at various levels of their understanding. So, Swamiji says even the Noah's Ark as a story which comes in the Bible is also one of the theories where it talks about there are two giraffes or two lions or two serpents and two every creature, and that was saved when the Pralaya came, and from there came the entire universe later on. Entire species were further produced from that on. If you take this as a theory, it is probably a theory at a very lower level, at LKG level, that this world is made up of pair of opposites, from there everything is created like this. Like this we can derive a message. But this is a theory at a lower level. But this is a fantastic theory here. Etasmat jayate prano manas sarvendriyani cha. Kam vayur jyotirapa prithivi vishvasya dharini. There is a beautiful sequence also that is given. Now, we have to understand that there is a beautiful play of the microcosm and macrocosm that is happening in this universe. In fact, this gives the solidarity to the whole world that it is real, and therefore we are going into the inquiry as to how this is all coming about. But first itself he says, Sa eva maya parimohitatma. It is a play of maya as it were. But what it is, we really do not know. But that has created this wonderful thing. Once this wonderful thing is created, we are totally involved in the affairs of the world. That's all it is. That is the practical reality that we need to accept. See, it is like somebody says, you go to that movie, it's a wonderful movie. The director has created such a beautiful scene and it's a nice story and everything is very nice about that movie. Let's say like a Titanic movie it is made. You buy the ticket and go fully knowing that it is a movie. But it is so well created that you get involved in that movie and you become part of that movie. It is like that. However much we may study the Kaivalya Upanishad, however much may we, be in this knowledge, it is the power that makes us draw into that reality of the world, making us feel that this alone exists as a reality. So, what is this play which makes it so engrossing? Suppose if there was a fault in the movie, if there is a very glaring miss that the director he has missed in the movie, immediately you point that out in the movie and you are not able to get fully involved there. But if the movie is so perfect and scene by scene emotions and everything is actually drawing you into that, and when it is so perfect you don't see any differentiation between you and the movie, you become part of the movie. Now exactly like that, you see that there is absolutely a perfection that is going on here in this universe, that we are part and parcel of the universe, we have been drawn into it. There is no way that we can see ourselves to be anything apart from it. That is why later he is going to say, Tebhyo Vilakshana Sakshi, you try to be witness of all these things. But it doesn't really happen like that. Now, what is that perfection? The perfection here is, there are these five elements which constitute the universe which is outside. There is this individual you who is experiencing this universe. There is a perfect match and coordination between this individual who is experiencing the universe. There are five senses that we have. These five senses correspond to the five elements there outside. Our ear corresponds to sound, which is aspect of space. Our skin corresponds to air. It feels touch because the air is there. Our eyes are able to see, which is the element of the fire outside. Our tongue is able to taste, which is the element of the water outside. The nose is able to smell, which is the element of smell outside. So there is a perfect coordination between the microcosm and macrocosm. In other words, both these microcosm and macrocosm, as we see as separate entities, he says, all have arisen from that same this etasmat, he says, from this only, from this Brahman only. Now go back again to the dream example to understand. Whatever you experience in the dream has arisen from that one waker's mind only. But that one waker's mind, when it spins the web of the dream, you become dreamer on one side and what you experience becomes the dream world on the other side. But there also we always say, your mind creates the dreamer and the dream world. It is never said that dream world and the dreamer. So it is the subject and the object. Exactly the same way here it is saying, Etasma jayate pranaha, manaha, indriyani. These are all referring to the faculties of the individual which experience the universe, which is subject. And then the whole universe, which is covered by these five elements, kam, vayu, jyotir, apa, agni. Kam means space, vayu means air, jyotir means fire, apaha, water, prithivi, which is earth. These five elements by themselves are inert matter. The subject who is experiencing these elements is more subtler than it. In other words, how are you saying that these elements exist? This is existing because the pramana for their existence is our indriyas. If the indriyas are not there, you will not even know the existence of these things. So the indriyas are more powerful than this. And the indriyas are connected to the mind. And the mind is connected to that vital force, which is the shakti of the life force itself. All this has emerged from this supreme thing. Now, according to the subtlety, also it is given, space, air, fire, water and earth are arranged from subtle to gross with reference to the elements. As I said, in our indriyas also, the subtlest is the ear, then the skin, then eye, then tongue and then nose. Now, why is it is given in this order? Because grosser the element, it can be perceived or contacted by more of sense organs. More can contact us, touch it. Gross means it is more manifest. So more manifest means it's more available for us to experience. That's all it is. So earth is contactable by all the five sense organs, or come from this side. Space, whose essential aspect is sound, only ear can contact. Air, you can hear the sound of the air, plus you can touch. So there are two sense organs which can contact air. When it comes to fire, it is the first element that is seen. So therefore, you can hear the sound, you can touch and feel the fire, and also you can see it. Water, you can do all the three, plus you can taste, and earth is that which can be contacted by all the five. So therefore the order of subtlety is here. Now if you are able to understand subtlety from another angle also, it works. That is why when we studied the other text, the order of creation is more or less given like this, but it says from that Akasha came. From Akasha came Vayu. From Vayu came Agni. From Agni came. So in other words, one can be telescope from the other, but final source is the same. So you can say everything came from this, or one came from the other, like this also. So it is interesting if you look at it that way also, that it is said during the Pralaya, where it is its absolute dissolution, the entire earth merges with the water, or is dissolved into water, as it were. It's called Pralaya Jala. And that Pralaya Jal is dissolved into Pralaya Agni. The Pralaya Agni is blown away by the Pralaya Vayu. And then finally it goes into Akasha and gets dispersed. And the Akasha goes into unmanifest. This is the order that is given in terms of dissolution. Therefore, if you want to understand creation, it is the opposite. From Akasha came the air, from air came fire, from fire came water, and from water came earth. Even if we look at the proportion of the pervasiveness of what we see in the universe scientifically, again, the same thing can be applicable in our body also, because yat pinde tat brahmande. The amount of earth and earth related matter, what pervades that is water, water and ocean and various other things, which is much much more and bigger than the earth. Sun and stars, which are other aspects of fire which is there in the universe, is much bigger than that. And the air that blows intergalactic space, everything that is far more greater and superior in force. And all of this is housed in a great thing called space. It is the same thing. But we really can't understand as to how one goes into that, etc. Because in the short term, what we may see may be even the opposite. See, we see that fire is doused by water. So, water seems to be more powerful than the fire. This is in our small limited experience. But when it comes to, or when you pour water into earth, the earth absorbs it completely. So, earth seems to cover water. But when a big tsunami type of thing comes, the whole island can be engulfed. The whole earth goes under water. So, when you look at it from a totality point of view, water is more powerful and it engulfs the earth aspect. And when you look at sun and its power of evaporation and everything, that sun will absorb everything else. And then we can't imagine what is that force of wind, etc. And then everything, what is beyond everything, is the space. So there is a beautiful order in terms of from grossness to subtlety, from small to big, even in the universe that we see. It is the same order that he has given since its creation. It is starting from the kham, which is space, towards this. But all these elements which are inert by themselves, how do you know that they exist? They exist because you experience them. So therefore, you who is the experiencer is greater than that. And that he talks about Indriyani. The Indriyani are the sense organs which correspond to these elements, and they are able to tell you, that prove that it is there. And greater than that is the mind. Greater than that is the prana, which is the life force. All this has to finally come from that supreme self. This is the order of creation that is given here. This mantra is mainly meant for contemplation. And the same elements, when you come to this mantra 8 of Mundaka, chapter 1, section 1, mantra 8, there he introduces one term in between here, which I will leave as a homework for you to think about. There he says, tapasa chiyate brahma tatonnam abhijayate. From that comes anna. Anna is translated as food. Annat prano manasatyam loka karmasu chamrita. From anna as the base, he says, then prana, mana, and then actions and various. This side of creation is, there's no problem. But the Vayamidya, there is given one word that is given there is annam. Annam is translated as food, but it has a special meaning there. So, what is it that is a missing link here? This is also correct. There's nothing wrong with it. I'm just saying there one more addition is given for as a food, that Anna can be taken as food for thought now. you can think about it. What is that Annam that he is talking about there? Then from that Annam comes Prana, Mana, Satyam and everything. Satyam is again great elements there. And all these translations which are not to be understood by mere Sanskrit terms alone. That is why we require the help of Acharyas and the interpreters and their interpretations to understand what is it specifically meaning in that context. It is, so how is food interpreted there? That is the key here. So from this, the support of the universe, this is the substratum of the universe, Vishwasya Dharini, this which is referred to in the previous mantra as Adharam, Anandam, Akhanda Bodham. From this, Vishwasya Dharini arises, the support of the universe arises, Prana, which is vital air, mind, all sense organs, space, air, fire, water and earth. We'll conclude. Yeah.
What
is
the difference between tapas and dhyana?
No, dhyana is meditation, tapas is austerity. Tapas in general refers to a concerted effort. Any concerted effort is tapas.
So with the help of tapas, we can either go towards multitude and come towards
No, that is in general talked about as self-effort. So that need not be, it can be interpreted that way. But tapas in general talks about a identification with a particular aspect or urge in you where you are putting in an concerted effort, that is called as tapas. Yes, sir.
The way one can't explain the 0.001% of how the universe started. Similarly, even for individuals, the first asana of it can't be explained.
Can't be.
Again, there is a connection between microcosm and macrocosm.
Correct. That's what I am saying. That 0.001, you can say it is vasana, it is atom, it is genes, it is DNA or it is cell or whatever it is. That cannot be explained or understood.
Even for human vasana, that first vasana cannot
It cannot be. We'll conclude with the bhajans here.
Om Namah Shivaya. पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते।